Okay, I had to turn my little mic on. Well, thank you for coming and thank you for taking the time out. I assume you're here to, you came for me, but it might be more that you got a free lunch out of the deal too, so it's a win-win for everybody. And I'm always fascinated because this happens in, when you teach class, nobody ever sits in the front row. It just, it's always like whoever comes last, they have to sit up front. So I've been asked to do three things for you. One is to give you a background of my experiences and why that's important for this position. Secondly is to talk about a vision for the college. And then third, to talk about my leadership style. So that's kind of the way the slides are organized. That's kind of the way I'm going to run the next 20 minutes, all right? I'm glad it's only 20 minutes because if we have till 1 o'clock or sometime thereafter, it leaves a lot of time for questions and answers. And I experience doing this stuff, that's when maybe a lot of the information that you want to hear comes out. So I appreciate the committee giving us that amount of time so we can just have a dialogue back and forth, okay? So here we go. I think. There we go. All right. So again, starting with qualifications and experiences. Not going to spend a whole bunch of time on here, but this is where I come from. All right. I started as a state school student in the state of New York. I went to a place called Cortland State University. It's just one part of the SUNY system. Graduated there in 1983. It's hard to believe time goes by so quickly. All right. My discipline's athletic training, so I did athletic training at that school in combination with physical education. Back in my discipline, if you want to be an athletic trainer, you went into physical education. That's how you got to the end back in the early 80s, 70s, and then up till now we have majors in athletic training, but back then we had to do it that way. From there I moved on to another state institution, Marshall University, down in Huntington, West Virginia. As a young man going, born and raised around the New York City proper, heading to Huntington, West Virginia as a young man, it was my first eye-opener too. Wow, life can really be different. Not that it was bad, but it was different. It was just a different setting. But Marshall was a great place to do my master's. And then after working for a little bit, and I'll have a couple of slides on that stuff, I wound up in Toledo, Ohio to do my doctorate in exercise science with my minor in anatomy. And I came away from Toledo with a PhD and a wife. So it was actually a really good experience headed to Toledo. So the point being is that's my degrees, and what I'm trying to do here now is try to wrap this into why is that important for this position. I do this in class, and I try to give students, because when you're teaching, you can give them a lot of information, but if they come away with one or two things a class period, I'm feeling pretty good about it. So I always have these pearl things. And now I haven't looked. Is my light bulb walking? Yep. Sometimes he walks, sometimes he doesn't. So if he's walking, I'm done okay. But the point being is University of Southern Maine, Lewiston Armand College within the University of Southern Maine, we're a state institution. That's where I come from. My education is all from three different states, but from the state institution system. So I feel very comfortable working within that confines, not private but state. So, Brian, why do you think you can be a dean at LAC? Well, I'm already the dean at LAC. I'm in my 26th day. All right. So, as Joyce rotated out, I rotated in, and I've been up here since September, as most of you know, serving as the associate dean. Okay. However, I have a previous deanship under my belt. I was an interim dean for 2 years at a College of Nursing and Health Professions from 2007-2009. This college does no longer exist at USM. That college and another school were collapsed along with the hard sciences from an old College of Arts and Science we had here to make what is now the College of Science, Technology, and Health. So my faculty role here, I actually am a faculty member in a different college other than LAC, and it came from this large part from the College of Nursing and Health Professions. But I did that for 2 years, and prior to that I was an associate dean within that college. So again, you know, experiences related to what I'm interviewing for here and that one has to do, I do have some dean experience across two different colleges on the two other campuses. So my faculty office here is in Gorham. The dean's office for, my old college and certainly the College of Science, Technology, Health now is in Portland. So I've worked across those two campuses. I've come up here this year to round out my career at Lewiston Auburn. It's a great spot, so I have a fairly wide view of the campuses from a dean's perspective. Now, prior to becoming a dean, let me just, for those not in the academy, this is kind of what happens. If you're a good faculty member, they figure you can be a good chairperson. And if you're a good chairperson, they figure you can be a good associate dean. If you're a good associate dean, they just figure you can be a good dean. None of us went to school for this stuff. We went to school for our discipline stuff. So I kind of reflect that. So as I go through this, you'll see I had chairperson experience prior to the associate dean and dean roles that I've held before and I currently hold now. So I came here in 1996, and between that time and 2005, I was the chairperson for then the Department of Sports Medicine, which is now called Exercise Health and Sports Sciences, a name change, content's the same. They actually hired me here to start that department. The department did not exist. I was a chairperson at Southeast Missouri State University, which is down in Cape Girardeau, Missouri, before I moved here. And they asked me, "Okay, can you put together a department for us?" And I said, "Sure thing. I know how to do that." So I came, and today we have three majors in that department with 385 students when we started in 1996 without existing. So across the last 20 years, I think we've done pretty well in that. And then from that chairship, I went on to the dean's office in the old college. All right, so why is that important? Well, I tell you what. The chair role, the director role, there's a whole bunch of responsibility for very little reimbursement at the university. It's a tough role. And I like to think I understand that because I did it here for 9 years. My last institution, I only did it for 1 year, to be quite frank, it was much more lucrative to do it. Here, not so much. Chairs here, directors here are typically faculty members along with the administrative responsibilities, so you have to wear both hats. So sometimes it can be a thankless job. So I think anybody coming into a deanship needs to understand that, needs to understand where individuals who are chair people are coming from, what they're addressing the challenges, and certainly I feel like I've done that. I did that role for many years, and I will never lose that perspective of what that's like. So coming down to the end of this portion of the presentation, I've been on four campuses as a faculty member. This is my fourth. I'm not leaving anytime soon. My wife and I have planted our stake here. I've been here 22 years. But prior to that, again, you see a place called Southeast Missouri State University. I started my career at a place called Lake Superior State University up in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan. And anybody who thinks Southern Maine has tough winters, go live on Lake Superior for a winter. It's really quite an experience. But the point being is I do have experience across a variety of campuses, and again, save for one, which is Mount Union College. Took a nice position there. Mount Union is a private institution. You know, I belong in a public institution. I've realized pretty quick I belong in a public institution. I just like the public students. I like the fact that we're always strapped for resources. I don't get it. But the point being is, you know, we're all in this together. And public institutions around the country, none of them are rich in resources, because we are public. Okay, so I feel very comfortable. You know, at a place like USM, I get to a place like Lake Superior, very small. At the time, it was a college, and it changed the name to university. And I was there. Point being is very similar to LAC with regard to it's a small place, and I owe a lot to Lake Superior for giving me my start, my academic career. Actually, I think the world of the place. So I should have had this up when I was just talking, but the point being is when you go through the faculty role, I've been an instructor in a non-tenure track line. I've been a tenure track faculty. I've gained tenure. I am a seasoned faculty member right now. So I'd like to think that, you know, a dean of college can understand where a non-tenure track person is at in their career, where somebody going through the tenure process is at in their career. I have done that. And basically what I did was I spent 4 years teaching and working as an athletic trainer, which is my discipline. And towards the end of that 4 years, I started to realize, you know what, if I want to do in my career what I want to do, I need to get a terminal degree. And so I quit my job and went back to University of Toledo to get my PhD. And that was a one of those learning processes type of thing that I realized that if I wanted to be able to stand here today asking for this dean job, I needed to do something when I was younger, and I feel very fortunate that I figured that out and went back and got my doctoral degree. Now, I am an athletic trainer, so, you know, I'm trying to round this out with regard to why is this important for the dean job. So there is a team that I was an athletic trainer with. You can see a young gentleman standing there. Right here, all right, that was a basketball team that I was with. We actually made the NCAA tournament. You know, 15 seed, went into the tournament. It was really close. We were really close right up till tip-off. And about 3 minutes in, I realized this isn't going to go very well, and it didn't. But, you know, we were able to make the, you know, not everybody can say they went to the big dance, so for 1 year I had a chance to do that. And then I moved on to Lake Superior, and, you know, what the heck with this conference championship? Let's win the whole thing. So there we are. That's the national championship team. See, there I am up here again. A wonderful experience. That was at Lake Placid, 1988, so it wasn't too far removed from the Miracle on Ice. Pretty neat. Okay. One of the things that cracked me up about some of this stuff is that the gentleman on right over here, if anybody follows college hockey, if you recognize, that's Jeff Jackson. He's the head coach at Notre Dame. Been at Notre Dame for years. He's one of the grandfather coaches now. Well, it cracks me up in my career when I look at, you know, Jeff and I were sharing a house in Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, trying to make a name for ourselves. You know, and you can look back, and they just lost the national championship game this year at Notre Dame. I feel bad for Jeff because he hasn't quite been able to get one at Notre Dame, but he did get two more at Lake Superior as the head coach there. So that's something else I've done in my career. And anybody care to guess who we beat in the semifinals to get to the championship game? Maine. University of Maine.
Oh.
Absolutely. It's another reason why I need the job here. I'm used to beating University of Maine. Right? Now, what does this have to do with anything? Nothing. But it's really cool to talk about. Okay, so I just offer you that. All right. So that's kind of my background, kind of where I've come from. And so let's get into what else, you know, the real substance of what the committee has asked me to do. First thing is, I can tell you what my vision is, and I'm going to, because that's what I've been asked. But I will say this, is that a vision is just not about me. It's about the stakeholders. All the stakeholders, Lewis and Auburn, need to be involved with in the concept of what do we want to be, where we want to go down the road. And that means community members, that means the students, that means the faculty, that means the staff, that means administrators, everybody who's got a stake in it needs to have input into the process. And should I be the candidate of choice, I'd like to do that with people around the table, okay? Now, that being said, there are some things I'm going to suggest that we do before we actually know what we're going to do, because there are just some things I think we need to do post-haste. But the globally, you know, if we're sitting around saying, you know, 5 years, what are we going to look like, we need to have everybody at the table to develop that vision. So what does that mean? All right? We need some core values. Now, we do have a mission statement here at Lewis and Auburn College. I love it. It's, you know, it's been around for a long time. I'd like to revisit some of this stuff with regard to, are we still in the same spot? But let's face it, we're here for the students, and that means they come, what am I going to learn? All right? And what are you going to learn here is we have to offer the appropriate curriculum for the Lewis and Auburn community. Okay, whatever that means, we have to make sure that we're meeting the needs of the community. And we need to figure that out. What we have today, I think, is great. I truly do. I wouldn't have come up here to be the associate dean if I didn't know, if I didn't think that what was here was valuable. But I also think that we need to start to rethink some of the things that we do and add on to some of the good work that we do. We need to have, that means we need to have the faculty. We need to have the quality faculty to get us to that point. We certainly need the staff support. Staff run the place. In other words, we cannot do what we need to do in academics, in academia, without the proper infrastructure and the appropriate staff to do that. In community, we have to engage the community. We have the CAB, the Community Advisory Board, is an excellent resource. I can tell you, not every college has such an animal. We need to build on that. I've already asked Marcel to look at the bylaws and say, you know what, let's make sure they're appropriate, and if not, let's make some changes to those bylaws to meet the needs of what we're doing today, okay? And the other thing is, you know, there's a couple of mantras that I will always take with me. One of them is to honor academic freedom. We have to be able to honor the faculty's ability to go into a classroom and have the freedom to address the issues of the day and to address the students as they best see fit, okay? So there's just some core values here, some things that I think we need to take forward as you're developing a vision. Because the ultimate goal is what? It's about the students. I was just asked by the committee in an hour meeting before this, what does student-focused every day mean? Because that's what we're saying here at USM. That is what the president's spouting. And for me, my definition of student-focused is if you have a conversation with me, and the students don't come up in that conversation with regard to the institution, I'm not going to hear you. It has to be about the students. So regardless of whether it's, you know, I need something for my lab or I need this for my classroom, we have to change this class time or whatever the point is, it's got to be about why. It's about the students. It's about student success, period. You know, and as long as we can make that case, then we can talk about the other things that are involved, all right? So what are we looking for? We need that infrastructure support to support our students. We need to have those services to help students be successful. We can't be as selective at USM. We can't be selective at our programs in Lewiston Armand College as maybe a Bates, Bolden, Colby can be. We're going to have a variety of students. We are a regional comprehensive institution, and by definition, we're going to serve the region. So you know what? We need to supply individuals with the support that are going to help them be successful. We want people to graduate. We want people to get out in the job market, yes, but let's never forget that part of a higher education is what? Is to make people lifelong learners, make them critical thinkers, make them an informed citizenry. That's the way we move society forward. And I do think at times in the academy that we forget that. You know, it's about skill sets, it's about employment, absolutely, but it's also about making people better people so we can have a society that we can be proud of. What does the community need? What does the state need? What does the student body want? Sometimes there's a disconnect. The students say, I want A, B, and C, and the employer is saying, I want X, Y, and Z, and there's no overlap. So you open an academic program because the employers say, this is what we want. Nobody comes because the students want something else. And then you offer what the students want, and they get out and there's no jobs. If somebody can answer that question for me, you know, you come up here and I'll go sit there because it's the hardest thing to answer. So what we try to do is what? We try to figure out what the students want. We try to figure out what the employers want. We look for that Venn diagram. Where do we overlap? And that's where we should focus. We've got to figure that out, okay? A wordy slide, and you know, parenthetically, let me tell you, I'm not overly technology literate, so you're not going to get a whole bunch of fancy stuff coming in and out of PowerPoint. I just give you the nuts and bolts. That's about as well as I can do. But this is what we offer, and there are some other things like certificate programs and things that I didn't put up here. But we basically have two sets of things going on right now in our building. We have the things that are part of Lewiston Auburn College from a structure standpoint. And then we have things that we offer here that are owned by other places within USM. So nursing we offer on this campus, but it's not part of Lewiston Auburn College in the sense that it has a different dean, a different reporting structure, but we offer the program within this building. Okay, same with education. All right. And this is going to become important, I think, as we get to the vision piece of where I think we need to be. Okay. So I actually have been asked by my boss, the Vice President for Academic Affairs, the Provost, to take a look at what's going on here and see about increasing the academic portfolio on this campus, increasing the academic portfolio at Lewiston Auburn College. Okay. So to me, that means two things. What can we start new? And then what can we bring up from the Portland-Gorham campuses that we already do, just like we're doing today. It's the same concept, all right? And we looking at offerings, you know, what degrees should we have? It's a simple thing as far as conceptually. Okay, we need this degree because we need this skill set. But let's not forget that we need the core curriculum. We need the liberal arts experience. Every institution says, students, you have to take a liberal arts experience. In our campus, we call it the core curriculum. We need to offer that in this building. And it needs to be sound. It needs to be healthy, because that leads to every degree program on the campus, is that we need a solid liberal arts experience. The other thing is that we can also offer post-baccalaureate, post-master certificate type of programs that, be quite frank, we can be pretty nimble with. We can get those up and running pretty quickly, find out what the business community might need, and they might have a sunset date. You know, we need this skill set at this period of time. So the point I'm trying to make here is that we don't always have to look at discrete four-year programs, graduate programs. We can look at different models of how to meet the needs of the community. It doesn't just have to be one size fits all. All right. And again, expanding the things that we're doing in Portland-Gorham, bring it up here, might be something else we look at. So these have already started. We've already started looking at some of the stuff. All right. And I put short term here because these are things that we can move on regardless of what the bigger vision might be, regardless of what the community might be saying. I think these things are here now. Let's do it. All right. Let's just go ahead and give this a try. All right. Early college experience for the local high schools, it's a no-brainer. We're sitting here. We offer stuff. People at the high schools want what we have. Let's make those connections. Let's get people in this building today, as soon as we can, within the resources we have and whatever confines we have to make that work. Getting things from the campuses that in Portland-Gorham up here that have already been approved through the system. And one of the things, if you're not in higher education, you have to understand that if we want to do something, there's a lot of hurdles to go over. But if something's already been approved, then we could be much quicker at offering some social service stuff up here, some health science stuff up here, STEM stuff. We do education in the building. I'm thinking maybe we can expand on that and do a little more. Certificate programs, continuing education, like I mentioned, that stuff we can be pretty nimble on. Let's get that done post-haste where it makes sense and where we can move forward with the support from some of the other units around USM. Okay. But we do need some data for bigger picture things. So I put up here things that are not long-term but longer. All right. I don't want to get caught in the paralysis by analysis. I don't want to be sitting there 3 years from now saying we haven't done anything because we're still looking at the data. We have to accept that if we have a vision of where we're going, we're going to try some stuff and some stuff's not going to work. It's okay to fail. If we're going to fail, let's do it quickly. Cost a lot of money. Let's move on. The point being is not everything's going to work out, but let's get the information that we can reasonably assume that this is what we need to do. So we are just wrapped up a needs assessment where we did a nice survey. We have some information already. This is on top of the stuff that we already have. Met with Becky Conrad just recently to talk about business community needs, and that's going to be an ongoing conversation, not a stopping conversation. But we had that frank discussion about, okay, what do we need to do here? And then we need to get down into underserved populations that particularly might be place-bound, and Lewiston might be a great option for individuals. We need to figure this out and figure out a plan, a vision of how to get those individuals here and get them the academic programming that they need, okay? So what I'm looking at here at Lewiston is this, is that we have, there's pieces of pie here. We have the community college is doing this, and we have Bates is doing this, and then we have the main College of Health is doing that. UMA is now in our building. They're doing some things. You know, where is Lewiston Auburn College slice of the pie? Where is that? All right, it's there. We just got to figure out, in addition to what we're doing today, what is next. So what do we need? We need a proper mix of undergraduate and graduate programs and that the certificate continuing education stuff. We need a proper mix of new degrees that we might start and degrees that already existed on the campus at USM that we can bring up. We need a proper mix of mode of delivery. Some students do great with online, some students not so much. Some students do great face-to-face, others not so much. So we can do synchronous, asynchronous, some blended stuff. We've got to figure out the proper portfolio mix of how we're delivering the academic program we have at LAC. So now we're getting into what do I think. This is what I think is going to happen. This is what I'd like to see happen. This is where I think we can go, okay? We need that core component. We need the interdisciplinary, we hold on to the interdisciplinary focus that the college has had since its beginning, but where it makes academic sense. So I think in some places it makes more academic sense than others, and then can we expand on that in things that we haven't even, we're not doing yet, okay? Involve scholarship, research, and creative activities, faculty and student activities together, all right? In addition to addressing the needs of the community, including the community in this regard, it could be internship placements, it could be bringing community members. I think there's a slide here someplace. But we talk about experiential learning involving the community. We go out into the community. We send our students to the community. That's exactly what we should be doing. But you know what we should be doing too? We should bring the community members to this campus, getting them involved in our coursework. Whether it's a guest lecture or a project or something, using the expertise that we have in the community, get them onto our campus. Okay, that will be, I just can't imagine the amount of intellectual knowledge capital we have in the community that we could use in our academic coursework that live in the Lewiston community. It's there. We just need to leverage that for the benefit of our programs, for the benefit of our students. So here, that's what I just mentioned. Student associations. I'd like to see whatever academic programs we have here have active student associations. Get them involved, okay, and whatever that may be. But a student association can take that classroom learning in addition to our putting people in experiential learning things and developing a culture, okay, of a group. You know, we have good research that says, you know, if individuals have a support system, they're going to do better. And we need to develop more support systems for our students. And one of the ways to do is have a peer support system through student associations. Now, we have a student government association for the college. That's great. But I'm talking about discipline stuff, you know, so they can help each other, you know, navigate through their academic careers, things of that nature. This was supposed to be a pyramid. It looks like a upside-down funnel. I'm a little challenged here, all right? The point being is, this is a model that was, and whatever it's worth, we don't make this stuff up. We always steal from other people. I heard this early in my career, and it makes perfect sense to me. If you're going to build an entity, you have to have a strong foundation. And everything's built on that foundation. So our foundation right now is strong. We have good programs in SBS and LOS and NAS, all right? We need to develop other things that are going to help sustain the college. All right? Now, what do I think does that mean? I think, like I say, I think we need the early college in the building. CC is the core curriculum. We need that liberal arts experience. I'm convinced, even without the outcomes data, that healthcare is part of the solution, is part of the vision, is part of where we're going to go. So we have a couple of programs in the country that are at two-year degrees. They're occupational therapy assistant and physical therapy assistant. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when they turn to four-year baccalaureate degrees. So we should be ready to pounce on that as soon as that decision is made by external entities that we don't control. But when those national organizations say, in order to be a physical therapy assistant, you need a four-year degree, we should be ready to walk forward to the state system and say, here it is. We can do that here. We know it's coming, so let's get it, let's prepare for it. And other health, I put other health, I'm not sure. We have to get this outcome assessment stuff, but I'm convinced there's other stuff that we can do. And building on that, we have programs at Lewiston, at USM that can be at Lewiston. We already have nursing and education. HS stands for health sciences. We do a health science program. It's in my academic department, actually. It needs to be here. We need to do it on two campuses, much like we do nursing. I wonder if social work, if that doesn't make sense also. the STEM disciplines. We do STEM in Portland, Gorham. We should do some stuff here. Not quite sure what yet. That's what we're talking about. We have to figure that out. But you know what? There has to be something we can bring up here. Public health, all right? Environmental science. These make perfect sense if we find out from our data that that's the way we should go. We should have graduate education, okay, selected graduate education. We already have OT and LOS, all right? But public health and social work certainly do graduate work too, and there might be other things, you know? And then the top of the pyramid is that continuing education stuff. Now, a lot of people look at this and say, well, what's on top is best. No, it's just the reversed. On bottom is the stability. Because if something fails up here, the whole thing doesn't crumble. You know, so we float a balloon for a certificate program. If it goes, great. Maybe that develops into a program. If it only lives 5 years, it meets a need, great. And then we get nobody to enroll. We say, well, we haven't expended a lot of capital into that. We were wrong. Let's move on and do something else. You know, but we got to try something. We have to move forward. We've got to try some of these things with the data that we collect and say, okay, let's pull the trigger on this or that. This is being done here, I'm convinced already, since I've been here in September and I knew it coming up. But some core values, you know, the vision is we have to continue these, and if we're not doing well in one area, we need to move forward. You know, but commitment to civility, everybody want to be here, students and faculty, staff for life. Embrace diversity. It's if we don't, we're going to be missing the boat. Equity among programs, okay, with the caveat that equitable does not mean equal. Just because somebody has five faculty in a department doesn't mean somebody else needs five faculty in the department. Just because my budget's this doesn't mean my budget has to be that. It has to be equitable across programs. And there are ways of looking at that and answering those questions. Okay. Be sustainable. Okay. Socially responsible. These should be some of the core values that I know they exist here already. We need to continue those and do better in places where maybe we're not doing as well as we should. So if I was in charge of the world, this is pretty broad because I think we need to drill down and get some more data. You know, but we should be the destination of choice for students pursuing whatever degree programs we have here. We should be the destination of choice. Okay? And I'm convinced getting people in this building, I'm convinced people getting them here, that's one of the biggest challenges. Get them through the front door, show them what we have. I think we'll be doing okay. One slide. Like I said, this is pretty intimidating. There's some leadership people in the audience here, and I'm, you know, never went to school for leadership, so. But I find this works, all right? So I try to be as transparent in every role I've played as possible. Put it on the table. This is where we're at. Get the stakeholders at the table. Try to figure it out, okay? Which is a shared governance concept. You know, I need faculty and staff involved and community members involved in figuring things out. Now, ultimately, a decision has to be made, and I get that. I have no trouble doing that. But I want to make sure that things are on the table and everybody's had their input until ultimately we got to move forward. Not everybody's going to like every decision. I understand that. I would hope people can leave that baggage at the door and say, okay, I'm on board, we move on. That would be my expectation, that you may not have agreed with the decision, but you've had your input and we move. And hopefully you're on that train because it's leaving, okay? So that's embrace diverse viewpoints. I don't want people at the table who think like me. I need two things. I need people smarter than myself, which is not hard to do, and I need people's skill sets that I don't have. And if you do that, you build a team, you can move forward, okay? I'm a little bit of a history buff, and maybe I went to the wrong profession, but I love reading about the Civil War, maybe our darkest moment in our country. And Abe Lincoln put people at the table that had diverse viewpoints, you know, some not even within his own party. And he made the ultimate decisions, but you know what? Reading through that stuff, it's very, very fascinating of how people thought how that should have been handled at that time, okay? Trust, empower individuals to get, you know, this needs to be done, can you please do it? There's nothing worse than somebody telling you please do something and then telling them how to do it. Everybody works differently. So, you know, if somebody does it, you know, this way and somebody does it that way, that's fine as long as it gets done. You know, it doesn't have to be my way. I have learned in my career, and it's always a challenge for me because every time I begin something, I think I do it. I just do it. So some people sometimes don't do it or don't meet a deadline, and so you have to verify at times. And as soon as you figure that out, you have to work with those individuals to say, look, you know what, I don't mind if you procrastinate, if that's the way you do it, but I need it by here, and this is what I need. And so sometimes you do have to do that verification piece. And I have to constantly remind myself because, again, when you surround yourself with good people, things usually get done. But you have to empower people to be able to do things. It doesn't always have to be one person. Okay? And then to prioritize. Everybody thinks everything's important, but we only have so many hours in a day. We've got to prioritize our initiatives, and to try to work through that is something that's important. So what I've tried to give here is a little bit of priority. I think we need to move as a college on certain things. We're doing it today. We're doing it already. And certain things we need to get some more data on. But the bottom line is I feel this college is ready to move someplace. So let's get going. If I'm the candidate of choice, I'm not coming up to sit in a chair. And my last deanship, quite frankly, has been around USM long enough to know it was not a good time. There was no moving forward. I had to try to save what I could save while I gave back money and gave back positions and gave back stuff. We're not in that time anymore. I want to move forward. I want to do things. So if I'm the candidate of choice, that's what you're in for. And again, some of it's going to work, some of it's not. But I think that's okay. But let's try.
A little longer than that.
Ike, yes, sir.
Recently, the chancellor came out with a set of assertions stating that liberal arts education can be enhanced at the same time that our graduates would be more or better suited for employment by adding applied education within the liberal arts education that we have. Is that something that you can embrace? Is that something you would resist? And if it's something you embrace, how would you assist your faculty to incorporate applied learning into your curriculum?
Well, I think applied learning, regardless of whether it's liberal arts or not, is important. You know, trying to show people why they're doing stuff. When I was asked to do my little song and dance about my history, right? Why is that important? Why is that important? You know, why are you telling us that type of thing? And I certainly do that in my classes. So to support faculty, we'd have to stand. Again, one of the things that, circle back to what I said, Ike, I'm a faculty member at heart. Faculty own the curriculum, okay? Now, this is parenthetically, faculty own the curriculum as far as what goes in the curriculum. The administration owns the pocketbook. So you have to match those two things because I could add a year to my curriculum right now in my discipline. I know we need it, but we don't have the resources. So the point being is if a faculty member or faculty curriculum committee gets together and puts applied learning within their classes, it's up for the dean's office, the administration, to figure out how much resources can we have to support that. And that's where I think the two come together. So we might want to do A, B, and C, and D, but the university might say we can only do A and B because that's all the resources we have, and we have to accept that. My job as the dean is to advocate to move these things forward, knowing full well that I'm going to be told no too, or no, we can't give the resources that we have. So my answer to your question is I would support getting the resources, but the faculty have to figure out what that applied stuff is for that specific course or curriculum. Yes, Lucian.
In your presentation, you referred to the LA community quite a bit. Might you define what LA community means to you?
LA community to me is anybody who wants to be here. By that I mean, we can take a compass and make a circle, whatever else. I've heard LA community being defined as, well, what's north of here, what's here, what's north of here, was it, anything south, no, that's Portland. Well, that doesn't make sense to me. If we have academic programming here that students want to come, if they come from Portland to here, so be it, all right? That being said, we need to start with the general geographic area here of Lewiston, Auburn, and some of the surrounding communities, And so if we can build that for that group, if somebody from Gorham wants to come here, somebody from Portland wants to come here, I would include that as our community. But we need to focus, you know, we can't offer something for them. We have to focus for people for here in the LA community. But I'd like to extend that reach, if we're doing the work here, to include maybe populations we haven't touched before.
Your vision statement is pretty generic.
Yes.
You can change most non-college to just about any college, and that vision statement would apply.
Right.
Is it too broad?
It's broad, but I did that specifically because I want the people at the table. But you know what's going to work here? Is healthcare and sciences. Because the sciences are the basis for healthcare and for STEM. And we need to figure out what health sciences and what STEM stuff we can do grounded in the sciences and the liberal arts with the core curriculum. That's what we need to figure out. And so I truly mean this. I want people from the community, meaning faculty, staff, students, everybody to say where we're headed together. That's where I think we're going. If I was in charge of the world, that's where we'll go. And that's the reason why I put that, well, a funnel, turned out to be a funnel, but the pyramid with the health and the sciences in there, because that is the trend. That's what we need. Now, I need, you know, working with Becky, trying to figure out, okay, talk to these employers, if there's other things that we're missing, we got to get on top of that. But my gut feeling tells me that's where things are going to be at. So I could have put that up there too. That's my vision. I want it to be our vision, though. I really don't want to be dictatorial.
I'd like to hear about your perceptions, your values, beliefs about faculty and staff development vis-a-vis student success.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if we have, if we do it right, we should have a process by which, this kind of circles back to what Ike was talking about, actually. We should have a process by which students are engaged in our coursework and faculty are overseeing that student engagement and whatever that means for that course or for that discipline. And then we should figure out a way to supply the resources to make that happen. Now, when everybody says resources, they think money. All right? And that's important. We need funds. But the resources could be many different things. It could be getting into the community and getting the community members, like I say, on this campus and that type of resource. It could give people some time to do some things innovative, all right? It could mean going to a workshop to allow you to expand your academic knowledge or your ability to be able to engage students in a different type of way. So if we could, I think every course should have some type of exploratory learning approach to it. Whether it's in the lab or whether it's in the community or whether it's even in a classroom, you know, we should have some type of active stuff. And I try to do that when it doesn't always happen. You know, some of my students, I see them nodding off, all right, I got to change things up. It happens to us all. But that is where the rubber hits the road, and that's what I think comes out to be a good experience, not only for the student, but for the faculty member. And I've experienced in my career that has led to some creative projects that might be a scholarship piece that a faculty member doesn't have to go out and create new scholarship. They're actually doing it in their classroom. Thus, the Boyer model of scholarship, which is very efficient. And that's what this college does. I'm hoping we continue with that because I think that is, for a comprehensive regional institution, a very good way to go for faculty productivity, faculty evaluation, faculty engagement. Hi, Tammy. Yeah. So let's face it, anybody up here, you know, you move from faculty member, you have your knowledge base, and you're a chair, and you're a chair of many different things, and you don't have expertise in everything. You go to a dean, you don't have expertise. So healthcare I feel pretty comfortable with because it's my discipline. So I would ask what community we talk about. We talking about the external community or within USM? With the USM. Okay, so within the USM thing, this would be my job to do, and to lay it on a piece of paper and say, look, we can do this, and here's the resources that are needed. But I would look at it another way and say, here's the resources we already have. All right. So if we start this new, it would cost X amount. We're not starting it new because we have A, B, C, D, E already in place, so it's going to be much lower. That's a little easier for somebody to digest, even if the little lower seems a lot. Look at all the stuff we've already done already to have that infrastructure there. So that is the conversation, I think, that can help move something forward. It's also nice to have individuals from the external community telling our administration, this is what you need to do. Okay. The analogy I always use is, I've done some consulting in my career. So somebody brings you in and says, well, how do you start an athletic training program? What do we need to do to get accredited? Blah, blah, blah. And I spend 2 days and I outline all the stuff they need to do. And the people on the campus in my discipline said, I've been telling them that for 2 years. Well, it's because somebody else told them. All right? I don't care how they get the message, as long as the message is there. It's kind of like raising my 17-year-old daughter. I don't care how she gets the message. It's not coming from me. If it comes from somebody else, it's fine. She doesn't listen to me. You know, as long as she gets the message, as long as the administration gets the message. So external community members can certainly help there in telling the administration what we've been saying all along.
Thank you. I'm going to pick up on Lucian's community question in a different way. You've been with USM for 20 years. What sort of activities have you engaged in the outside community, outside of USM?
Right.
I mean, see, these things that you put together, they're 20 pages in length, are hard to read, but I didn't see any of that.
Right. Yeah, and I, you know, right now there's a dean search for the college that I'm a faculty member in, mm-hmm. and somebody sent a 40-some-odd page vita, all right? We try to balance those. I get it. Okay.
Listen.
We try to balance that. No, it's a great question. When I first got here, my work in the community was specific for my discipline. So I was out at every clinical site that I could imagine to send my students to in healthcare. Where am I going to send my students? Building that network of resources to make sure that when we go from the classroom to the laboratory to the community, which is clinical sites, that they were available and they'd be receptive. So that's the bulk of my work there. In my deanship, I worked with the main one I did, because I was in charge of nursing, was to work with Maine Med in trying to figure out how to increase the ability of Maine Med to take our nursing students into their clinical work so we can increase the workforce. And actually, that turned out to be a right, I think it still exists today, don't quote me on it, but a collaborative effort with some hires because the community, Maine Med, went ahead and put some money up, to quite frank, so we can increase our nursing faculty members so we can have more students, you know, that type of thing. Here, since I've gotten here, I have tried to get to everything that I can, which means the chamber breakfasts, it's CMCC's foundation, okay? I've met with the hospital, all right? Now, it wasn't me setting up the hospital as a president, so I just tagged along, things of that nature. I'm going to Tree Street tonight for their annual dinner. So the point being is, in this role here for this community, the external work is much more important, is much more embedded in the dean job than in other places. And I tell you, my last time that I did this as far as a dean, it was more or less trying to keep the ship afloat. That's kind of what I did. I understand the role of the dean here to do that, and I'm trying to get out in the community as best I can to learn the needs. Every time I go to community breakfast.
That's part of the job. How about away from the job? You volunteer for anybody?
Oh, sure. Boy Scouts, my son, mm-hmm. okay? I've been that. I coach his little league baseball, mm-hmm. okay, type of thing. Years ago, I currently sit on, and I have to check if I'm still active, the Department of Financial and Regulation for the state, which regulates licensures and stuff for my profession in the state, okay? The interesting thing about that one is I haven't had a correspondence in years for them, so I don't know whether I'm still on it or not, you know, that type of thing. So I've tried to get out and do that type of stuff, all right? I will tell you that one of the things that I've made clear to the provost and the president is that my family comes first, so that's going to, you know, when I sit down, I look at, you know, going to Tree Street tonight You know, I'm missing my son's track meet or my daughter's track meet today. Perfectly fine, I don't mind doing that, but I try to limit how much I'm away from my family. So I do try to do that. I don't live in the Lewiston-Almer community. I live down at Standish, okay? That's where I'm physically located. I'd like to be able to pick and choose those spots that are gonna benefit us the best here in Lewiston-Almer, okay? I can't tell you I've figured that out yet, all right? This is where I've told Joyce. I said, Joyce, I said, you can leave, but as long as you're around for advice and counsel, all right, because I see all the stuff that Joyce, and I said, you need to advise, counsel me, if I do move into this role, of where I'm gonna most have the best impact. And that's what I plan on doing.
Thank you.
Hi, Mark.
There are several people, several institutions in the Eastern Auburn area that are delivering healthcare education, CMMC. I'm just wondering how you would invite or reconsider at all, how you would invite, how would you approach that competition, and whether there would be any conflict with what they do.
Right, so the question is, do we, if somebody else is doing healthcare, you know, how do we not be in competition, or how does that work? One of the things I think we need to do is go out into the community and figure out from those places, what are they doing, all right? So what can we do separately, but also what can we collaborate on? And that collaboration can mean many different things. In other words, if we need to offer coursework, for example, and another entity needs to offer coursework, and it's the same type of coursework, but neither of us have faculty. Can we collaborate on a hire or a part-time hire or something that would benefit both institutions? If we're looking at using the same clinical sites, and I deal with this in my profession right now, because UNE and us, we do the same programs. You know, so we go use the same clinical sites. Can we sit down with the clinical sites and figure out collaboratively, you know, how many students from LAC will we take from USM? How many students from a different entity can they take in whatever discipline we're talking about? So I think it's those type of conversations that we need to have and see where the needs overlap and then where we can do things separately, you know. The healthcare piece of the pie is, again, that mid-level, baccalaureate-level provider is where I'd like to concentrate on. And I think the health sciences coming up from Gorham, if I can make that work, I think that'll help answer that question. I don't think it's the be-all, end-all. But I think it's something that we need to pursue, you know. And the best that I can make of it within the region, as far as the other institutions, they're not doing that piece of the pie of what we're talking about. So I think that bodes well for us. Yes, Mike.
As mid-management, are you an advocate for the faculty or the employee of the president? And I ask that in terms of the president's initiatives, two of which that have been cast upon us, one, the inclusion of UMA, and two, the potential move to downtown.
Yeah.
So how do you juggle being in the middle of two opposing, potentially divergent attitudes?
Well, if I'm the candidate of choice, I'm going to find out, aren't we? Let's not forget that The dean serves at the pleasure of the provost and the president. That's clear. That's the way it is. At the same time, I circle back to where I started. I've been a faculty member since 1985 in some form or fashion. I'm always going to be a faculty member, and I will say this to the provost and the president when I have meetings with them coming up. I'll say, you're going to get a faculty viewpoint from me, maybe more often than not, okay? The move of the campus, the potential move of the campus, is gonna be informed by a futures committee that the president is putting together as we speak, okay? So the master planning committee that is looking at Portland and Gorham is just about done at their, they're just about at the end of their, you know, their report's gonna come out. So Glenn has already started to ask, you know, let's get this futures committee together to look at physical space for LAC. I don't know where that's going to go. I don't know what the outcome of that's going to be. I do know we need people in this room on that committee. I do know we need people from this community. We need faculty and staff people to have input there, okay? I will certainly be an advocate for what's best. I'll be quite frank, I'm not sure what's best. I'll put it out there. I don't know whether it's best to stay here or move downtown. Obviously, people say one thing, others say another, and they're in, you know, polar opposites. So I need to learn more about what that means, and I'm pleased that we have the time to do that through this Futures Committee. I really am. I would like to know what the faculty think about this, in particular the faculty, because of academic programming. It affects academic programming if we were to make such a move, okay? And then I'm going to have that conversation with the president provost, who look at things a little differently, and a lot of times it's through the what? Financial piece, you know? And one of the things about an institution is that we have things at institutions that will never make money. They just won't. But you have to have them to be an institution. And there's no other way to put it. You know, so Janine, for what it's worth, is a classics person. Classics don't make money for institutions, but we have to have classics. We have to have that knowledge base to have an academy. So the point being is, even if this building loses money, it begs the question, is that okay to absorb that loss because it makes us a better institution, it makes LAC a better place? That's the question I'd like to answer in this process, because it can't just be about financial stuff. It has to be about that whole bigger picture. Is that a fair assessment?
You talked about early college students.
Yes, sir.
Why don't we have them? Or why don't we have as many as we should?
If the world lines up correctly, there's a gentleman in the back seat here, and we're going to have early college on this campus for Redwood Little High School in the fall.
Why don't we have it now? I mean,
it's complicated.
Everything's complicated. Well.
I've been here since September. I can't speak to why not. I can speak to we should be doing it. And when Jim and I started talking about this, we were looking at fall of 19. And as we got further down that road, I think I looked at Jim one day and said, why don't we do this fall of 18 if we can make it work? And so we're trying that. So I can't speak to why it hasn't happened. I can speak to a vision of a few years from now. Is that we have Everett Little, we have Lewiston, we have anybody else who's in the region, we have an early college experience on this campus.
So you spoke of more baccalaureate programs. Do you think that would cause a need for housing on this campus? And then if so, would that sway your direction of thinking of where the campus should be?
That's a big question. For housing, residential, I'm not opposed to it, but the residential housing piece for a campus is typically not the purview of the dean. Okay, now I'm trying to skate the question, but I don't know enough about residential housing to know whether it's good or bad today. I'm probably going to learn about it in this process. If it's good for the students, if it's good for the programming, then the answer has to be yes. How to make that happen through a private entity, through the state, I don't know. So I don't know. I have a real good answer for that one. Because, I show up for work regardless of the role I've been in, and we have residence halls, and I go to my office, I have work and my labs, and but housing is a little bit abstract, all right? If, in fact, we need to have places for students, I do wonder if there's not entities in the Lewiston-Auburn community that can help us with answer that question, okay? That might be something other than residence halls. Partnering, as Mark asked, with other institutions that might be struggling with the same type of thing might be a way to go. Learning curve for me. I need to learn more about it. Did I see Lucian?
How do you plan to interact with the community advisory board? What role do you see yourself playing?
Well, I would like to be as active as possible. I would like the community advisory board to be as active as possible too. All right, and by that I mean, I did ask Marcel. I said, let's take a look at these bylaws. Let's just see if they're accurate, if they need to be updated. The membership, okay? Let's see if we have the individuals that we need on the advisory board, all right? I would like the advisory board to be an entity of its own to inform me as a dean of the pulse of the community. It's not for me to tell the advisory board what to do. It's kind of like a student group. You know, student groups, they want, oh, tell us what to do. No, you go ahead and tell us, and you, same thing with the community advisory board. Tell us what the community needs. Tell us what we need to be doing. How can we help the community? And that's got to come from the people on the advisory board. So I would, you know, I would like for that to be a symbiotic relationship in that way, because certainly everything the community wants to do, we're not going to be able to do. And certainly we might want to do stuff the community is saying, no, you know, stay away from it. That has to be a sounding board for that. And that's the role I see the community advisory board is, to keep us honest, to keep us on task, to keep us what we need to do. And I'm willing to be involved in that process in whatever extent it needs to be able to get us to the end, to get us to where we're going. Yes?
This may sound negative, but it's not intended to be, but you come across being fairly weak on the advocacy side for a dean at Lewis and Auburn College. We've, over the years, have had some serious issues with the administration of Portland as well as Augusta. How can you convince me that you'll be literally standing up for LAC, for the good of LAC?
Yeah, I understand that, and here's how I understand that, is that we have four colleges, okay? So the job of a dean is to advocate for their college. The job of a chair is to advocate for the department, all right? So please trust me when I say that just because you're here in Lewiston, that the other deans in Portland are not advocating, they're doing the same thing the Lewiston dean's doing. It's that advocacy for your college that is of paramount when you're sitting at the table looking at resources. It comes with the territory. I get the fact, and we just talked about this in the meeting prior to this. I've sat in Gorham for most of my career. If you don't think people in Gorham think we're Portland centric, you got something else coming. Gorham feels the same way as Lewiston. Now, I've lived it, so I know up here it might be a little more magnified, but I've lived it in Gorham. The Portland-centric piece of USM is not going away. How do we leverage the Lewiston Arbor community to get the Portland-centric piece of USM to recognize what we do? It's the job of the dean up here, and I get that. I have no problem telling the president and provost what they need to hear, not what they want to hear. I've already done that in my short time up here, okay? This is what you need to hear. Now, do they take that advice or not? Sometimes yes, sometimes no, all right? I have no trouble, okay, pushing that agenda if I'm passionate about it. I will say this. I will say there are things in Portland that we should not hold at arm's length, that we should embrace because they have more resources. And start to figure out which one is which is the way to go. Because the days of an entity standing by itself in this University of Maine system with this one, it's bigger than the USM, this one university thing, is not the way to go. It has to be, what can we bring from Portland? What does Portland do well that can help the LAC community, the LA College? And that is a piece that we should embrace because it's going to make the whole institution stronger, it'll make LAC stronger. But I'm fully sensitive to that, Lucian. I know what you're talking about. For what it's worth, I sat on Faculty Senate for 9 years. I was the chair for 2 years. Blake and I worked together for years together on it. I had lunch with Betty 2 weeks ago. You know, I'm fully invested in what it is to be the dean up here. You know, I don't have all the answers, but I like to think I get it.
More of a comment than not, but so the Chip and I are on the same page on that issue. The reason the community has advocated so strongly to have a dean here is that we want a seat at the table, you know, in Portland, and we want that advocacy for LAC. The day we lose that, we lose LAC. And again, we think dean here has to be more than a conventional academic dean. It's got to be a real strong advocate.
Yeah, and for what it's worth, yesterday I sat with the chancellor who was on campus. So they had the leadership meeting with the Board of Visitors, and we're sitting around the table. And they spent 10 minutes talking about the master plan for the Portland-Gorham campus. Perfectly fine. They talked about all the different things that's kind of come out, you know. They were ready to move on, and you just have to trust me. I raised my hand and said, okay, Mr. President, let's talk about the Futures Committee. What are we doing with LAC? That's my job, to make sure that that's not forgotten. And you can verify it with Cliff Grimes. You know, it just, I have always done that at that table, and I always will do it for as long as you guys want me up here.
Just going to pause for a minute and acknowledge that we are beyond our time. We'll let Brian take a couple more questions before we close things out.
Yes, Ike.
And building on your last answer, you had earlier talked about the success of nursing, on how a second campus brought a program here. Original members said they'd never come up here, so new faculty were brought on who embraced the idea of coming up here. That's a success story. For every one of those, we have a dozen less than successful stories of departments not embracing coming up here. So my question, to fill your pyramid, you're going to have to repeat the success of nursing and overcome the failures of ESP, chemistry, biology, just to name a few. How would you envision repeating nursing success and avoiding biology, chemistry, and ESP's failure?
Yeah. Well, the first thing, a lot of this goes to relationships. All right, so I'm going with low-hanging fruit with health science. This is my department. I know the individuals there. But it's not a way out in left field either. It's not like we're bringing something up here I don't think will work. And I mean that sincerely, you know. So it's one, is building those relationships. And two, it's really, hopefully, having the advocacy of the provost office to be able to work with the individuals, the programs, to come up here. The third thing I would think is that, just talking about the CAB and other people from the community, is to make sure that the individuals we're talking about, the faculty we're talking about, understand the importance of whatever academic programs we're moving up here is needed by this community, and it circles back to the students of why we're here. I told you we're going to fail. I know some of the failures that have happened in the past. That shouldn't stop us from trying. You know, and I'm not saying try with the same entities. I'm not trying the same way, but trying nonetheless. Into making that work. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't tell you it's gonna happen. You know, I like to think it would, but I'm willing to put myself out there and give it a try. Yes.
How do you see yourself coming here as the leader of the staff, as well as
Yeah, one of the things, I mean, if I'm the candidate of choice, I'd like to have a meeting with the staff and just find out the pulse, the temperature, what's going on. I mean, not that I haven't been doing that since I've been here, but the point is, let's just have a frank discussion about the concerns, you know, what keeps you up at night, that type of thing, okay? And then if we need to put in place some processes by which, all right, we keep those lines of communication open so people know what's happening, what's coming, what might affect individuals that keep you up at night, okay? Let's face it, I don't know where this is going either. I mean, we have vision, I think, you know, we do this, do that. But the part of my experience has been when people start spiraling down like that, it's just sheer lack of communication. It's sheer lack of what's going on. Most people can address things if they know and they're honest about what's happening. And that's what I'd like to do. The second piece that I would say to any staff member, and I'll say it to it now, and I would say it in a meeting like that, it's okay to make mistakes. I get the feeling sometimes people are so afraid that if they do something wrong, that they're gonna be punished or penalized or something. You know, we're all human. We make mistakes, and it's okay to make mistakes. So I wanna get over that hurdle that, you know, if something goes amiss, you know, there's very few things in life we can't fix. I mean, it's okay, let's try to learn from it, not repeat it, but you know what, mistakes are made. And we need to feel comfortable in a workplace that, you know, you want to hear about my latest screw up? I mean, I make mistakes too, you know. And it was a big one. It was a big one. It was, you know, I sat on a peer review committee with my colleague, okay, in my department. Peer review committee, we did our evaluations just like we're supposed to as faculty. Moved it right along. Brian, you're the associate dean now. You can't be on the peer review committee. Now, I've been here 22 years. I know that. But I was just trying to be a good citizen. I was trying to do my job as a faculty member. As soon as I got the call, I said, you got to be kidding me. And of course, I laughed about it because I was like, you hit me with a wet noodle. You know what? Yeah. So they had to do the peer review committee without me. Right? That was a big one. That's a union thing. That's a big one. So I'd say right on camera here, I made a mistake. But it wasn't unfixable. It was something that we can fix. And I think that goes a long way for employees, that it's all right to be human.
Thank you, everyone, for making the time to be here.
Thank you for everybody taking the time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Very much.
Thanks. Appreciate it.